Thank you so much for clicking on today's video from Elm Grove Baptist Church. We're so thankful for the continued support and the continued prayers from our church family, as well as friends of Elm Grove. Over the past few days, we've been privileged to have videos from what were to be our guest missionaries for our 2020 Missions Conference. As you can see by this banner up behind me, the theme this year was Missions, Are You Involved? I pray that you are. Each of you should have received in the mail a faith promise card. What this allows our church to be able to do is to understand and to designate the funds that we are expecting for the year to be able to support our missionaries who we are currently supporting and those who we hope to take on throughout the year. But it helps us to understand how we can best support them and their ministry. Over the past few days, I hope that you were encouraged as much as I was by the different missions fields that God allows for the missionaries to go into. I'm so thankful, and I pray that you have received this successfully. Also online, you can check out the Elm Grove Baptist Church website. On that website, we have designated missions and missions conference page on there. Through those pages, you will then be able to also fill out a faith promise giving. That way, we know for sure what we're able to do in regards to the Great Commission through Elm Grove Baptist Church. Thank you so much for the continued support. Please enjoy today's service.
El Shaddai, El Yonah. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to tonight's Bible study here on Wednesday. First, turn your Bibles, if you would please, to John chapter 14 and verse number 2. Actually, we'll read 1 through 3, if you don't mind. Turn in your Bibles to John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse number 1, 2, and 3. I thought I'd talk about something good, something exciting, something I'm looking forward to seeing, something I can't wait to get there, something I have talked to a lot of people about. Over the years I have been in the ministry, I have been at the side of those about to leave this world for a better one. And I want you to know, I want to encourage them when I'm sitting there beside them, how wonderful, how exciting, how beautiful heaven will be. John chapter 14. We'll read this verse and pray and get into our Bible lesson tonight. The Bible says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God." Jesus said, "Believe also in me. In my Father's house," that's heaven, "are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." Then he says, "I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye must be also." Dear Jesus, thank you for that hope of heaven. Thank you for that beautiful place that we will spend eternity in. Thank you for that prepared place, that place that you have taken time out to fix up for all those that love you, those Christians who have put their faith in you, those whose names are written in this Lamb's Book of Life. We're so thankful that you have a place waiting for us that is so much better than this place that we live in today. Father, again, bless this service. I pray, Lord, that you'll help us now be able to get through this COVID-19 so that we can get back into church and get back into the places we normally go and like to eat, maybe at restaurants, but there's so many different places that we like to go to and can't right now. So, Lord, I pray that you will heal this land up and get rid of this virus. In Jesus' name, amen. Heaven, the home up above. You know, folks, one of the greatest things about my job, one of the greatest things about the occupation that I have, one of the greatest things that a preacher of the gospel gets to do is talk about future events. Now, if you look at the book of Revelation, it's set up actually in three parts. The first chapter, of course, talks about the past. Then you have chapters 2 and 3, which talk about the present. That's talking about the churches. Of course, we live in the church age today. Then, of course, chapters 4 through chapter 22 talks about the future, the past, the present, and the future. Chapter 1, the past. Chapters 2 and 3, the present. Chapter 4 through 22 is the future. Just like chapters 1 and 2 and 3 take up almost 2,000 years or more, ladies and gentlemen, chapters 4 through chapters 19 deal with only 7 years. 7 years. And the tribulation, Jesus comes back at the end of the tribulation and on white horses. I get excited about that. And we will set up the kingdom with Jesus and reign with him for 1,000 years. What a wonderful, exciting time that will be. Coming right out of heaven, right back down here on earth on white horses. I get excited. I get excited about the fact that he has prepared a place for us. Now, I think about the things that I've seen in my lifetime. You know what I've seen? I've traveled every state and many countries in my lifetime. Been very fortunate. I have been to see beautiful, beautiful sights. I've got to see in Mexico the beautiful rivers down there. I've seen the beautiful rivers in America here today. I've seen the beautiful mountains. And I've seen all the things that God has provided that we have in here. Even the beautiful wheat fields of Kansas. What a beautiful sight that is to see. To come out of Arizona into San Diego and the beautiful, beautiful breeze coming off the ocean as you come out of that area. What a beautiful sight to see. The rolling hills of the Dakotas. I've been there. The beautiful scenery that you find on the East Coast through Pennsylvania and all those wonderful states up there. What a beautiful, beautiful sight to see. Ladies and gentlemen, but nothing. Now, it took God 6 days to make that. Now, think, 2,000 years he's been gone. How beautiful heaven must be. I'm looking forward to that. Let me just share a couple things with you, if I may, please. Heaven, and you can write these down if you would like to. Heaven is a happy home. The Bible says there is a place of no sorrow. Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 talks about no sorrow in heaven. It's a happy time, glorious time. It's time you'll spend with your loved ones and those of the Bible that you've read about, those that you've talked about for years. It's a beautiful place God has prepared for us, a place of no sorrow. I know I have been around a lot of sorrow in my lifetime. I have seen a lot of sadness. One of the things that I have as a preacher is to preach funerals. And those people are saying goodbye to their loved ones. And how sorrow that is. It's how sorrowful it is. How sad it is. I remember when the Bible says that Jesus wept. He wept at the funeral of Lazarus. And I think it's because he looked over and seen all those people that loved him. And now he was gone. And that brings tears to my eyes. I think about all of them. There is so many things in this world that makes me weep. But there will be no sorrow in heaven. Praise the Lord. I hope you wrote that down. It is a place of no sin. Woo! Won't that be wonderful? A place of no sin. Good night. You don't have to worry about those ghetto areas that we face today. There's places in Chicago that's not safe for a man to go. There's places you can't walk streets late at night. Women can't, nor men, nor kids can walk anywhere. We have to worry about our own streets and even safe harbor places where people will just drive by and shoot you. I'll guarantee you there will be no sin. There will be no pornography shops. There will be no places of ill repute. Look, there will be no beer joints. There will be no liquor stores. There will be no things that literally destroy people's lives. There will be no sin there in heaven. You won't hear swearing. You won't hear that. You won't hear dirty jokes in heaven. It is a place of no sin. According to Revelation 21, verse 7, nothing that defiled will be entered into the kingdom of heaven. There will be no place, it'll be a place where we can rest from our labors. Oh, I tell you one thing, you can get tired. In this day and age, I'm getting up there in age. I'm now 74 years of age. I can't do what I used to be able to do. I get tired easier. I require naps nearly every day of my life now. But one of these days, we're going to go to a place where we can rest from our labors, rest for eternity. In a place called heaven. It is a place of rest, folks. Everybody needs rest. Everybody craves rest, desires it. We will have an eternity of it. What a wonderful place that will be. Heaven is also an inhabited home. Okay? It's going to be a happy home, but it's also going to be an inhabited home. Heaven is inhabited by God the Father. According to Daniel chapter 7, 13, heaven is where Jesus is at, according to John chapter 14. I read that a while ago. The Holy Spirit will be there. What, ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be a wonderful place inhabited by God. And what a wonderful time we'll have up there. Heaven will be inhabited by Christ, of course. Heaven will be inhabited also by those that are redeemed, those that have been saved by the blood of the crucified one. Those whose name is written in the Lamb's book of life will have a place to spend eternity called heaven. What a wonderful place that will be. I can't wait to see. Now, I fantasize a lot. I can't wait to see Moses. I really do. I can't wait to see him. I can't wait to see Jesus himself. I can't wait to see Daniel and David and Jonah. I can't wait to see all these ones I've read about and preached about for years and years. Noah, I can't wait to see. I can't wait to see Isaiah, Jeremiah. I can't wait to see all the minor prophets, the major prophets. I can't wait to see Peter and Paul and those who walk with Jesus. I can't wait to see them because they'll be there. And I want you to know I'm going to be right there on their heels just visiting with them. What a wonderful time we'll have in an inhabited heaven, inhabited with God's people. Also, in that place, we'll have a heaven that is a desired home. Now, there's a lot of places that's not too desirable here on this earth. I remember as a boy growing up, I was placed in a children's home. To me, that was not a desirable place. I wasn't with those that I love. I wasn't with my family. I was with people that did not love me. I was with people that disciplined me without love. I was in a place that just was not desirable. There in this place today, we have places that are not good to go to in this country we live in. Can you imagine all the bad streets in every city we have? There is certain places that you just don't want to go to because they're not very desirable. But heaven is a desired home because our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, because of our inheritance which is there, and because we are going to be united with Christ in that wonderful place. What a place that is desirable to go to. We're going to be where people talk the same language we talked. We're going to be with people that love the same Jesus that we love. We're going to be with people that want to talk about the things of God like we do. What a desirable place. What a good Bible study. Just to think about heaven. Just to think about being there and going there and getting there. In fact, getting there is exciting. I hope we get to go at the rapture. I do. Now, rapture is the word's not in the Bible, so don't get all shook up. But the word caught up is in the Bible. And the word caught up means you get caught up to be with Jesus in the air, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. That is what I'm looking forward to as soon as I can get there. And just to get up and go to be with the Lord, and the excitement of getting there, and exciting of being welcomed there, and excitement of just being around God's people. Exciting times are ahead of us. Heaven is an eternal home. You might want to write that down. Not only is it a happy home, an inhabited home, a desirable home, it is an eternal home. I give unto you eternal life, Jesus said. Well, how long is that? Forever. How long is forever? That's forever and ever and ever and ever. I hear it particularly. I'm a Baptist. I believe in eternal security. I believe in that. I believe that once you get saved and get born into the family of God, you can't get out of it. You're in it. Now, you may not be perfect. You may do some things wrong. But, you know, when you're born into your family, you do some things wrong. But that's okay, because the Bible says, I give unto you eternal life, and you shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. So if you did not, if you can lose what God gave you, you never had eternal life. You had temporary life. I have eternal life with Jesus Christ. Can't wait to get there. Can't wait to be with him for eternity. Can't wait for that new phase in our life that comes after we leave this life on this earth. Heaven, an eternal home, eternal for the believers. It's going to be eternal occupation. We're just going to, whatever he have us to do for eternity, I'll be glad to do it in a place of rest, a place of excitement, a place of love and compassion, because it is also, ladies and gentlemen, a home of eternal beauty. Now, you don't know about you, but I like beauty. I love beauty. I love seeing the beautiful mountains and the beautiful stars at night. Listen, I love to see the beautiful flowers and the beautiful birds as they're singing in the spring. I love the beautiful snow when the snow comes. I don't like snow all that much, but when it's out there and it's fresh and it's new, it's very, very beautiful. I like the fall time when the leaves fall, and the springtime when the leaves bloom. Listen, there's a lot of beauty here, but there's more beauty in heaven. There's where we're going to spend eternity. Beautiful. Can you imagine how beautiful heaven must be? Not only that, but it's a perfect home. A perfect home. Unfortunately, today we live in a world where there is homes that are sad, broken. I came from one. But not there. In that place, we're all going to be sanctified and united together. We're going to be there for eternity. Happy, loving together. It's going to be a perfect home, free from wickedness, free from uncleanliness, and it will be a marvelous in nature. What a wonderful place that's going to be. Heaven. I get excited, folks, thinking about it. The Bible says heaven is going to be a prepared home. Bible says I go to prepare a place for you. Prepare. I've been a guest at many homes in my life in the ministry when I've gone and preached revivals and different things across America. And then when I got there, the first thing the wife of the pastor would say is, Brother Siva, we have prepared a room for you. Oh, it's always been a really nice place. Really a nice place. Listen, I like it when people prepare a meal for me. I like it when we have got together for a prepared time of fellowship and love and getting together and to have an exciting time together. But heaven will be a prepared place. It's going to be just perfect, just right, just the way it needs to be. Heaven, what a wonderful place that's going to be. It is going to be a place prepared by Jesus. It's going to be a city prepared by God. And it's going to be a place for prepared people. Those that have prepared themselves for heaven by receiving Christ as Lord and Savior. You see, you got to be saved to get there. If you want to go there, see, you say, well, when you're dead, you're going, I got to tell you today, when you're dead, you die and you become worm food. Ah, how sad that must be to him. Not me, buddy. When I leave this world, I'm leaving it for a better world, a prepared world, a prepared place called heaven. Waiting for me. Heaven is an accessible home. It's an accessible home. Heaven is accessible by Christ. Christ died for us so that we could go there. He shed his blood so we can live there with him for eternity. He came to die. He came so we might live in a place called heaven. Heaven is accessible by faith. You put your faith in him, and without faith it's impossible to please him. So you put your faith in him, saved by grace through faith, and you receive Jesus by faith. You can't save him, no, not now you can. But by faith I believe that he died for me. In fact, I was over in Jerusalem not long ago, went to the place they buried him, he ain't there. Everybody's in their grave, but not him. He's gone to heaven to prepare a place for us. Wow. And when he said, if I go to prepare a place for you, I'll come again. Now, Jesus has never lied to us, so he's coming after us. I hope it's before I do die. I'd like to go up in the rapture. That would be a wonderful experience for me. Heaven is accessible by conversion. You have to be converted. You have to be saved, ladies and gentlemen. You have to be. You just can't go and think you can be good enough to get there because you can't. You've got to trust Jesus Christ. I want to ask you something. Just a simple question for you to think about tonight. If all you had to do to get to heaven was believe in God, then why would God send his son to that terrible death? Why would he send his son to die that terrible death? Why? If you could do it your way, then what's the purpose of God sending his son to die? What was that purpose? You see, God had one way and the only way that you could get to heaven. And that was a way of the cross. And he sent his son to die and suffer that agony on the cross. And ladies and gentlemen, as I looked up on that hill just last year, seeing where them crosses were, knowing that up there on that cross, my Savior, who loved me despite my sin, despite my hateful attitude sometimes, besides all the things I've done wrong, Jesus died for me on that cross. As I looked up there, I said, oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you for preparing a place for me and giving me an opportunity to live for you. Ladies and gentlemen, what a wonderful. Heaven is accessible, but it's only accessible by the new birth. It's only accessible by conversion. You must be converted. You must be changed. You must give your heart to Jesus. You must get a new heart, receive him as Savior, and I hope you will do it today. Now, how do you know you're going to heaven? Here's how you can know it. Here's how you know. Because the Bible says so. The Bible says so. I'll go to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's what Jesus said. He wants us to be where he is. We also know for a fact because of the Spirit, which is your witness. The Holy Spirit of God has taught me and taught me the Bible and has showed me peace and the prosperity that comes by being a Christian. The Holy Spirit of God will teach me and guide me to the place called heaven. It teaches me about heaven and then guides me to it. Listen, because the life you now live. People look at Sandy Sieben and say, oh my goodness, he ain't the kid he used to be. No, I'm the man God wants me to be. I have been changed. And the Bible says, listen to this now. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Often worry about people who say they got saved but never changed. Therefore, if anybody be in Christ, he's a new creature. Are you new? Does people see a new you? Does Jesus live in your heart? Are you going to go to heaven when you die? Are you going to go to that happy place, that wonderful place, that beautiful place? Are you going to go there? You can only go there by accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. Do it tonight, my friends. Ask him to save you now. Now, ask him to save you now before it's eternally too late. Father, thank you for this time, this lesson on heaven. What a wonderful place this will be. Thank you so much for our church. Thank you for the people. Thank you for all those who watch this service, however they watch it. Thank you for them. Bless them, their families, their lives. Keep them safe. But more than anything, prepare their hearts to meet you someday. In Jesus' name, amen.